So Kurt, you might say a few words, and Mike's playing, and Shankar. So Mike is going to follow, and he's going to do a lot of the heavy lifting with the Kubernetes stuff, and I'll kind of give a prelude to that. And Shankar and Mike now work together, which is...
My role is just to drag him here. That's
yeah. actually, before Shankar started...
So Shankar, when did you start working?
Like a month? Oh, when I started working? I don't know.
I didn't know you worked.
I just hang around.
Yep. So whenever we got the idea for this talk, which was probably, I don't know, 3, 4, 6 months ago, it was a while ago, and I'm not sure what triggered it, but it actually preceded Shankar leaving to, you know, where he was to where he is now, and so conveniently, we looped him in anyways for any thoughts on this evening's talk, and it turned out that the new place he's working is with Mike, who's an expert on the Kubernetes stuff, and so... a while back, maybe a month or so ago, there's a pretty active Go group and Docker group. Is anybody a member of like the Docker meetup groups? So Mike, you see, he truly is an expert, right? So, and about a month or so ago, there was a thing over at the Google offices where they basically, it was like a code lab for a Saturday morning. It was really terrific. And a guy, and I copied some of his slides, and he said we could share them. It was about a 3-hour sort of Docker introduction, so we're not going to go through all of that. We'll do the high-level stuff. And then they did another 2-plus hours or so on the Kubernetes stuff, and I was lost. I mean, I wasn't completely lost, but I was pretty lost. You get pretty deep, pretty quick, and it's pretty complex. So we're very fortunate to have Mike join us to talk about some of this stuff. Kurt and I, we talked earlier today with some other folks about a few of these things, and some of the story here is about scalability, some of the story here is about spinning out microservices to all sorts of different nodes. Some of the story, I think, is the new data center of the 21st century and sort of how you kind of scale these things up. Kurt, your thoughts on any of this?
Well, so they did a study, I think here at MIT, about how people, if you need lots of resources fast, lots of resources or some resources fast, there's a spectacular amount of people just go straight to AWS. And that's even here at MIT, when all you have to do to tap in another couple thousand cores is to get an account on one of these services. Lincoln Labs has a couple hundred thousand servers that you can get an account on and just attach them to your process. If you go through the rigor of putting your code into an MPI form, there's a couple of hoops you have to jump through, but AWS is far and away the most popular scalable server solution that academics use. And if you look at the price per flop, AWS is 10 times more expensive than any integrated cloud solution that you sign up for. There's a new service. If you want to use ARM processors for your experiments, there's a site called runabove.com, and you can just click in ARM as a service for 3 pennies a core per hour or something like that. It's ridiculously cheap. Way cheaper than AWS. But AWS is simple. But I think that's what, at least in academia, if someone's got a big problem that they need to scale up to 10,000 processes, they use AWS to this day.
So there, and all this stuff is relatively new, I think, over the last, handful of years, basically, where, I don't know when Amazon Web Services, first started as a commercial venture to the public, but it wasn't much more than about 5 years ago, right? Mm-hmm. Google App Engine was one of the earliest for, as a way to kind of instant on kind of resources at your disposal. So the part that I'll kind of kick off with is some of the basics around the Docker concept. And because Go as a language is something that's of interest to me, and coincidentally is the language that Docker was written in, and in some sense I think their success is intertwined. I think the success of the Go language has really come about in part by the sudden thrill of Docker. And I think the success of Docker has come about in large part because of the capabilities of the Go language. So the folks behind Docker, they had had a previous kind of similar sort of platform, and it was written in Python, basically, and it was around for years, I think. And it was one of these, you know, cloud service kinds of provisioning things. It wasn't any big deal, but then when Docker came out, it just, you know, within the first month, 6 months, it just really took off. Maybe it was the timing. I think a bunch of companies kind of piggybacked on it, including Google and others, and that certainly helped a lot. But okay, so we'll get going and we'll see where it goes. We'll have some demos. So it's going to be a little bit of you know, going to be a little bit of system level talk and a little bit of code level talk. So you know, really, the initial release of Docker, it's only 2013, so 3 years ago. But it is written in Go. It does live on top of Linux, so it's the kind of a natural tie-in to the whole Linux thing, and it is open source as well. The main idea, and correct me, Mike, in particular, if I'm wrong anything I say here, but the main gist of this is that the concept of a container is just like a container you see rolling down a highway, and people stick all kinds of intermodal shipping containers became a hugely transformational innovation in the shipping industry, because what they were, what business, global business in particular, was suddenly able to do was to take a similar rectangular size container, stuff all sorts of everything from dolls to food to, and throw it onto cargo seagoing vessels, stack them all up in neat, secure, reliable ways, and ship them. And then when they get to the other side, they unpack them, and all this kind of funny-shaped stuff spills out of it. But the container itself was a standard size and shape, by and large.
I think this was spectacular accidents.
And spectacular accidents? From?
See some very dramatic photos of news when the ships put around all these.
Oh, is that true? I haven't seen that. Yeah.
So someone hits more. Well, actually, you must see it on Facebook, I guess.
Yeah. I mean, you know, there's probably been a few Docker, calamities as well, but. But the benefits, hopefully, have outweighed the costs, because they're still putting these things on ships. And again, the beauty of it is you take them off the ship and you throw them onto tractor trailers, and tractor trailers kind of go down the highway and that. So there's a lot of thought that went into how these containers were designed originally and engineered. And that sort of is the inspirational concept, at least, for the Docker stuff. But the key thing is that it's kind of a thin layer, and where you take all the application wares and you compile them into a binary, and then they live on top of a kernel. Okay, so as compared to, kind of MVS, multi-operating system types of installations, where you have what are referred to as guest operating systems, where the entire guest operating system lives and runs on the machine, and you've got multiple operating systems running on one machine. That's one model, and that's kind of the hypervisor model, where you're coordinating all of. The Docker model is different, which is that you just take the application layer, your databases, your web servers, your software, you know, application space, and all of those share the kernel. Okay, so not every one of those containers has its own kernel. They share the same. So there's a measure of commonality which ties it deeply to Linux, but it somewhat simplifies the. And we'll see a little bit more of this. Okay. So here's the very rough agenda. Oh, first and foremost, John, you want to talk about the free book that people can get access to? There's a link to it, how you kind of find your way to it up here.
Just looking at a cable up here.
Oh, take whatever you want.
No.
So there's, thanks to John setting it up with Marcy and O'Reilly. If you go to this website, www.o'reilly.com, pubget, blue.org, they've got a handful of books which we kind of went through and helped through there. Catalog and said these look like Docker interesting books. And so if you go up there, you'll have to sign up for an O'Reilly account, but you'll then be able to gain access to one of the titles that they have. And I guess I could pull it up and show it to you. But the one that I downloaded is, so each person is able to download one book, and there are a couple different Docker books. The one that I downloaded is this one right here. And you can, I guess you can read it in a whole bunch of different formats, but the one I downloaded was PDF. So it's kind of a pretty cool deal. And
yeah, it used to be O'Reilly would occasionally send us books to use as door prizes, but they changed their policy recently. Now they only send books like that when one of their authors is speaking on the subject of the book.
Yeah.
But they said that they can do this thing with e-books.
Yeah.
In this case, we don't have to wrap them up, because everyone can basically go to the download page, create an account, and upload one of the books.
The publishing industry has really, thanks to Amazon, has really gone through a tremendous amount of change.
They also have a subscription service where you get everything in their catalog plus several other companies for $400 a year or $200 a year, I forget.
Yeah, they have. I mean, they clearly have a great stable of.
Their Safari service had a sale at the end of the year, so I grabbed the half price sale price.
I mean, I'll actually. I guess I'll just pull it up and see what happens here.
While we're doing, how are the lights? Can everybody in back see? Because I can dim these lights up top if anybody needs it.
It'd be nice if these weren't so bright.
Excuse me?
It would be nice if these here weren't so bright over us. We don't.
Well, let me see. I'll turn them down a little bit more.
This is why I keep my hat on here.
And if you would adjust the lights.
So these are the five books that are currently up there, so you can kind of basically get your pick of whichever one. So thanks to the O'Reilly folks and Marcy, and thanks, John, for setting this up. I think it's really a great deal.
Thank you.
Okay, so now the two main pieces of my stuff, to the extent I can keep on track, one is about Go and one is about Docker. So Go is this, has anybody written anything in Go, the Go programming language? So Mike, once again, Mike, at least I'm glad we're the ones who are...
I'm just trying to be honest.
I'm glad, that's good. Go is a fantastic language, okay? I'm completely biased in this respect, but I mean, I've been through a lot. I've said to Kurt that, you know, if Grace Hopper were alive today, I think Go would be her language of choice.
I think everyone says that about their language.
Yeah, maybe, but some of us have been through language evolutions of, you know, different stripes, and I'll show you a little demo of some stuff. I came to Go, and Mike will maybe tell us how he came to Go separately, but I mean, I've done a bunch of, you know, how many people have got the Ritchie and Kernighan C book from, you know, way back when? So it's a good sign that Kernighan is one of the authors of the Go programming language book. It's a little bit thicker than, but it's in, you know, similar quality to what was the Ritchie and Kernighan one of C. And you mentioned Thompson earlier in the evening. So Thompson, Rob Pike, and there's another guy, I guess, are three folks at Google who came up with the design of the Go language. And it was some number of years ago, I don't know if it was 6 or 7, thereabouts, but the concept behind it was they needed something that would compile fast, and that, you know, so they wouldn't have to be, the developers, particularly at the Google offices, wouldn't have to wait forever for this stuff to compile. And they wanted the compilation, you know, that whole compile, link, and go stuff that some of us have lived through. And they wanted to simplify that so that and make it more efficient as well, right? So in terms of all the dependencies and things like that, if you have a compiled language, historically, people have had to worry about. So these are things that, for those of you, how many people have done Python? How many people have done Ruby? How many people have heard of Dart? So, right, so I mean, it's, you know, and how many people have done C or C++? So the extent to which you've done C or C++, you'll find Go, I think, infinitely pleasing. Some of the attributes that it has that, you know, I'll show some demonstrations of, it's, so the standard library in C is, you know, it's typically like, you know, printf and other kinds of, a handful of things, that there's a very large standard library in Go, where you're able to do all sorts of stuff with images and networking and, you know, and of course the routine stuff of file management and operating system, and even runtime analysis of it's got this thing called Go routines where you can kind of spin off separate processes. It's kind of like threads on steroids without sort of the, you know, some of the other issues you'll have. So this guy Rob Pike, who Kurt pointed out earlier, it was a Plan 9 guy. You want to just give a pitch on Plan 9, what it was?
Yeah, so he was he's one of these Bell Lab guys. Plan 9 was in lockstep with some of these other great ideas they had at Bell Lab, like C and Unix. Did you do Plan 9 for a while, Bill?
No, but I'm aware that it's basically a complete redo Unix done right.
Yeah. Treating everything like a device. Like you write, write to a socket as if you were, catting to a file.
So you get these guys together and in an environment like Google, where they have real world problems to solve that really touch all of us in a consumer commercial sense. And they seem to, in some sense, be very different individuals, but they all shared these challenges. And so the one of the design sort of procedural constraints that sticks out in my mind is that no feature would go into the design of the language unless they all agree to it. So basically the goal was to have a minimalist simplicity in their design, but features that really addressed core challenges. It turned out that Docker came along. It had been in Python, and somewhere along the way they decided to take it to the next level. And it was about the time that Go was coming about. They looked at it using Go as a way, in essence, to break from the legacy of the other stuff that they had for a clean break. And I'll come back to the 60 Minutes thing just as a public interest story later on. But let's. Okay, so we talked about this. There's a link that I'll post for Jerry and John. There are a couple of good 20-minute videos. There's one by this guy who was one of the original Docker developers, and there's another one, I don't know if I have a link to it or not, by Rob Pike has done a number of good YouTube videos at these. So GopherCons are the conferences that are held, I don't know if it's annually or semi-annually, but they move around the world and they focus on Go. And then, of course, all this stuff is available on YouTube today, so yeah, you can get it right from the voice of the experts. But this was the challenge. This was just cribbed from his video. Well, on the left-hand side, you've got all this complex myriad of software applications, and then along the horizontal axis here, you've got all these different hardware platforms, right? And so the question is, how do you sort of deploy this mix of hybrid software to this variety of hardware? And so their solution was Docker, basically. These were the original Dockers, and you see them. They're essentially palletizing stuff. They'd stuff it into more or less rectangular, similar shaped packages, and then hoist it up and ship it off. So the idea of Docker is you can take all your variety of software, package it up into this Docker container, and then off you go. There is this concept of, I don't know if people, are people using Docker in your operations? So maybe as when Mike talks about it, if you have ideas, in some sense, the simple attractiveness of it is you don't have to worry about that. For instance, one example is Go. If you want to install Go and get up and running on it, one of the complexities is you've got these pathing issues, and it does have sort of a fixed sort of directory structure of binary and source kinds of file systems. And if you don't have anything quite set up right, your stuff just doesn't run. It's not very hard once you get it running, but if you wanted to just pass it off to somebody sitting next to you, it might take a little bit of work. What you can do is instead you can just pour it into a Docker container, and you can then pass the container off, and the container has, not only does it have the Go language compiled into it, but it's also got your application compiled into it, and it sort of filters out the dependencies on path hierarchy and stuff like that. And I'll show you an example of this in some working code. But the idea of microservices is, if you've got lots of little snippets of code that you need to quickly spin up and shut down, I just can imagine that every cell phone that's in use could have a Docker service, container attached to it, right? So these, they tend to be, in fact, a statistic that stands out from that code lab that we went to, the Kubernetes guy, I think it was, somebody had done a profile of the average length of running time of Docker containers in some, sizable commercial operation. And so the question was, how long do you think the average runtime is for a Docker container in this big operation? And it turned out to be 0.1 nanoseconds. So whereas you might think that there'd be long run times for these, in fact it's not. The containers are geared more towards quick starts and quick stops. So that's where the microservices stuff comes in. It, you know, it's almost like there's an app for that. There's a service for that. Here's just a graph. This is this guy, Nick. Part of what I'll share after the meeting is his code lab. Very easy to walk through. You could do it on your own machine in your own time. But he contrasts essentially the difference between the, this model over here, where you've got the guest operating systems. They could be different flavors. They could be, you know, Red Hat or Debian or whatever you have. Whereas in the Docker environment, they share the operating system. So it is a constraint in the sense that it relies on the same version of the kernel for all these different applications. So it somewhat limits the use or application of this, but it's currently, I don't know that they'd ever change that, but that's kind of the way that it works today. Let's see what we got here. Okay, so what I'll do is I just want to give you a quick look at what Go looks like, the language, and you know, this is kind of hacky code, but I don't mind. I'm not too vain to show it. So this is using the Atom, A-T-O-M, developer environment, IDE. Has anybody used Atom before? So yeah, a few people. So what was the other thing in Java that was the most popular kind of IDE for developers?
Eclipse.
How many people use Eclipse? So a few more, right? So, I mean, is that a comparable, you know, that's, so anyways, Adam came along, I picked it up maybe 3, 4, 5, 6 months ago, but maybe it's relatively new, maybe a year, maybe two, I don't know. I first saw it when they were talking about essentially adopting, providing support for Dart in it. So the idea is you've got a framework, and then you add these little tools or toolets that allow you to do things like, you know, code analysis or code highlighting or grammar checking or linting or a lot of different things. And then you can install these different little tools, basically. So one, for instance, is a terminal of all things. So there's it's just, you know, it's kind of a terminal program, and you actually install it into the Atom IDE, and then you've got essentially an integrated terminal. Okay, so what we have here is we have this is Go code, and you can tell by the, you know, .go, and it's really nice because it allows you to build sort of you know, I've always had this problem where when you've got multiple files, the question is how do you refer to them and how do you link to them and how do you compile all this stuff together, and that's kind of the linkage problem that becomes somewhat of a nightmare when you've got like C or C++ and you've got to manually, you know, sort of keep all those things neat and tidy. Well, Go almost goes to the other extreme, which is that if you put a library in there, but then you don't use it, well, and I'm not actually sure if it's the Atom editor that does this or Go, but
the compiler.
It's the compiler. The compiler, it gets rid of it, right? So it's this minimalist view that enforces essentially good development practices. So this is the stuff that when you were doing C or, you know, less so with assembly language, but, you know, it was just so painful to go back and clean up. We're not even talking about factoring code, just talking about cleaning up, you know, unused, dead code. Now the compiler, it does, you know, if there's a variable, if you define a variable, and it's really great because in the language Go, you can define these variables on the fly. You don't, you know, you don't have to type it, but if you have a variable that you set a variable equal to the return value of some function, it automatically picks up whatever that type is from the return function. You don't have to explicitly declare it. However, you can declare variables explicitly, but then if you don't use them, it actually forces you to remove them before it compiles. Okay? So in essence, the development build cycle really forces, in a painless way, an efficient model for developing code. And of course, whereas Python and Ruby and some of these other fun dynamic languages, they don't provide compiled code. So you don't have the performance benefits. Now with this, the compiler is just so fast that it, you know, you really can't tell that it's compiling stuff. Anybody remember Lightspeed C? You know, a few, right? So when that came along, it was bonus points if you know the name of the company. Think about it for a minute.
What?
What was the name of the company that did Lightspeed C?
ThinkC.
Right. So, anyways, it was a very fast, efficient C compiler. And
I realized that was it. Make mistakes faster.
Is that what it said? That's what the tagline was. Make mistakes faster. So that's a good one. So, anyways, this is in the spirit of that. I mean, that was a long time ago. But this stuff compiles so fast that it feels like a dynamic language. But then what you get out the other end of it, in fact, the way, and well, I'll show you, well, it's running right now. You can say go run, and it will just run the app, you know, run your software. Or you can say go build, and then what it will do is it will build. And you don't have to, if you've got stuff working, I'll show you how it comes together. Okay, so you have packages, and then you import files. This is all pretty standard, you know, standard stuff, right? But if you import something and then don't use it, I think it works pretty hard to get rid of it for you. And likewise, if you have used something but don't import it, it kind of, you know, gives you some hints there too. Here's where you define types and variables, but if you don't define variables, then, you know, and structures. Structures is something that has been missing from, these other dynamic languages, at least I've always felt. There's, you know, in object-oriented programming, every object is in some sense a structure, right? So you can kind of get it. But this actually brings back real, live, useful structures, which I find. You've got a function, okay? So this is a motion-detected function, and it's got some activity amount. So this is a webcam. You can see the lights on. And so what it's doing here is, so the code looks pretty, you know, it's got comments, and it's got... it uses brackets where it's got a funky for loop. It doesn't have fours and whiles and do's and eight different versions of this stuff, but one variation gets you a long way. Okay, so we'll go down. We'll see that this thing is running, and what it's doing is there are two things running in this. One is essentially a process that's capturing images from the webcam, and the other is a process that's actually a web server that's running. And so what the camera is doing is it's going, and this is where you get this kind of funky hierarchy. That if you don't get this right, I'll come back to that in a minute. Okay, so here is the code, and this icon right here is what it looks like when you get a binary, right? But you don't have to get to that level to actually run it. What the application is actually doing is it's recording these images. So if you look closely, you're in here somewhere, probably. By the way, we're recording this meeting for anybody who really wants to.
15 frames per second?
So, I don't know what the frame rate is, to be honest. But that's a good question. So it's capturing the images, and then what it's actually doing is it is... there's also a web server, and this is, it's a three-year-old Dell laptop, so it's not exactly, a crazy fast machine or anything like that. I'm not sure this is going to be.
Well, that's the 10-year-old Dell.
Yeah, that is true. So, what this just did is it went into this browser, just talked to the web server, which is written in Go, and it said, get me the images, which were just put onto the disk by this other Go process that's running, that's capturing images from the webcam, and then it's populating this page. All this is doing is it's taking the images that were captured in the current hour. So if you wanted to, say, capture, or if you wanted to look at images captured in the previous hour. This was, not, this is what I was doing when somebody was trying to find out where I was, but anyways, so the point of this is to show that you've got a web server running, you've got, an image capture program running, and it's all written in Go. So what the webcam does is, and this is a little bit of an anecdote, so I wanted to capture these images, and I thought, how am I going to do that? Have people used OpenCV?
Yeah.
this open computer vision. So, you know, it's very versatile, and it's originally developed by Intel. It was a great way to kind of sell chips, because if you can do stuff with imaging, you need faster chips, and so they were pretty well incented to push this stuff out. Eventually, it went open source, and it's got support for a lot of, like, Python and dynamic language support, and C and C++. And in fact, there's somebody who's, one of the other nice things about Go is that it has a nice way of interacting with C and C++ libraries. So it's, you know, you can get right down into the Linux kernel stuff pretty cleanly. And on Linux, there's Video for Linux, which is a standard that many of the camera manufacturers have adopted. And so I thought, well, how am I going to get the images off of this USB connected device? OpenCV. So I tried OpenCV. And, you know, sure enough, after it runs for about 20 minutes of continuous 15 frames per second or whatever, you know, my gigabytes of RAM is gone. And I'm like, well, how did that happen? So it's this memory leak that has been in OpenCV for forever, basically. And you know, so I do the Google search thing, and it's like I'm losing memory in OpenCV. And of course, in 50 different places now, 10 different places, I see, you know, we've got this problem with OpenCV. It's leaking memory on Bob. We got to fix this. And that was like in 2011, you know. So then I thought, this isn't going to work. So I did find somebody who had come up with the headers from basically to talk to the Video for Linux stuff that is embedded in the kernel, and that's what this is doing. And I'll and so to go back to the Atom IDE, that's what this blackjack thing is here. Let's see, actually, where is it? Yeah, I'll just show you. I guess I can show you the server stuff. The beauty of this is that it doesn't take much to spin up a server. So what you basically do is you've got a core chunk of code, and then I'll just focus on this. And then as inquiries come into the server, you pass it off to handlers. And the handlers are based on, you know, sort of what the path or what the URL looks like, or you know, any variety of other things. And then the libraries exist inside of Go to do all the, you know, HTTP stuff. And I think one of the new features is support for HTTPS, so you can actually set up, you know, secure kind of stuff as well, okay? So what you have here is you have, you know, here's all the, if you've done any kind of web-based development, it's all World Wide Web kind of standard stuff that they're doing. Very impressive, and since it's open source, it, you know, there's been a lot of a proliferation of, there are a lot of examples of Go out there, so it's easy to kind of find your way through. Okay, so then, any questions on Go as a language? Yeah.
Yeah,
good question. So I think it's a strength and a weakness of like here, okay? So these things, these are all the standard libraries, right? Math, random math, net HTTP, OS stuff, string conversion stuff, etc. Then what you can do is you can add in third-party libraries, basically. And this one happens to be one for imaging stuff. And so, to you know, your point, actually, what I wanted to get back to was back here. At some point I said, you know, I want to come back to this when I explained this to, okay. So here within the GitHub folder is kind of my local stuff. But again, it's a little bit of the structure that you have to apply to make this stuff work. So prior to actually running these applications, compiling these applications, what you do is you kind of do a command go GitHub, and it pulls the stuff down and it locally. And so then what you're doing is you're referring to, let's see if I can, so for instance, the specific one we were just looking at there, github.com disintegration imaging, actually is referring to this folder here, okay? And essentially this is just, Go code, which it then compiles at the speed of light, basically. So let me, I'll open one of these.
very standardized.
Their code tools are cloning the key repository, breach library.
Breach when you import, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know, it would, on the one hand, I guess it would be, like for instance, I don't know, maybe you know, what happens if the library's been updated on GitHub? You know, does how do I pick this up? For instance, in Atom, which has a similar package management thing, it's periodically checking this. Look, this one's, you know, there's a new version of this out there. I don't know if there's a new version of the imaging thing out there.
I think they generally push where everybody can be running master and everything is stable, but they do have the ability to do versions.
Yeah, it doesn't grab the latest unless you tell it to, and so there's actually a package manager, I think it's called GoDeps or something like that,
yeah.
Where it takes basically an image of the exact versions you're using when you, you know, compile and stores that in the repo as well.
Yeah.
But yeah, the whole hierarchy of your local disk has to be their very opinionated way of, you know, github.com/your username/whatever. And you can use other, you know, other sites, but that's kind of like the model they went with, and like it's you have to pass a ton of flags if you're gonna do it another way.
And it's a little bit of a headache to set up, but once you get past it, it does, you know, for instance, once you start compiling stuff or building stuff, that just all goes away. It's easy to pick up binaries and just move them over some other place. But yeah, so it basically is copying, it's doing this library management stuff, and it's pulling things down, and you've got it, you've got all the sources on your machine. So the point that we talked about earlier was, you know, looking at these, you know, so these are all the, you know, all these things have just like kind of showed up on my machine and you know, fairly recently. And so you got to start to wonder, where's all this code coming from, you know? And so the beauty of open source and the sharing development world is that you're pulling stuff from everywhere. The downside is that do you really know what it is that you're getting? So for instance, I was assuming with OpenCV, that, you know, of course you reasonably expect you should be able to pull images in from a, you know, imaging application and not experience massive memory leaks, right? But, it, you know, that wasn't the case at all. The beauty of Go stuff, it's all very readable, so it's easy to kind of poke around and find out where you're at. But that's what's going on, and they're leveraging the GitHub as a model for where to put your code and share your code. Any other Go questions?
So if I take your binary and I copy it to my laptop, will it run?
Yeah, assuming it's not like a Macintosh, right? If it's but it's a good, you know, and there are cross compilers.
It cross compiles everything.
It cross compiles everything?
Yeah.
So you could compile it on a Linux machine for an OS X target.
Yep.
Much like Kling that way.
Yeah.
Statically links by default, so you don't have to worry about linking to like DLL.
So it's just one file moving. Procedure, you don't have to do the whole.
Yeah, yeah, but it's still x86, it's not a FAT binary, right? No, or maybe x64 or something.
Don't know.
So when I, you know, so this.
Question real quick.
Yeah, sure.
So if it statically links everything, what do you do about security updates for some third party library?
Great question.
Recompiles.
Well, the problem is that it means if you have if some library has a security hole, you have to relink everything that links to that library rather than simply replacing that library.
Yep. Does Go provide tools to do that, is it? Is there some way that some distro that's providing some package that was written in Go can?
You know, there might be a Docker application. I mean, you potentially, you know, because and the way kind of Docker works is that you put the code in there and then you compile it and then you run it and you're off and going, and maybe some combination of Kubernetes which is controlling these different installations could, you know, trigger rebuilds or updates, maybe. So maybe that's something Mike can follow up on. I don't know. That's a good point. I think that it is, you know, it's a problem with statically linked stuff. The upside of that is that you know what you've got. You know what bits are there. The downside of, you know, more dynamic environments is that there's such a constant state of flux that, you know, you do got to wonder where all this stuff is coming from. and how do you control it? I don't know. When I do, I just wanted to show you. So I'll get rid of the binary. I just got rid of that. And the way you would build something instead of running it is. So it's built it, and there it is again. So this isn't a gigantic, but there's a bunch of files that it just rebuilt in that. Now I don't know how you would build something for like the Mac or for another environment.
It's just another flag.
It's another flag.
Yeah.
Okay. So for our and it does support a whole bunch of platforms.
Yeah, there's some flag that you pass that then it just builds everything, not just your current one.
Yeah. So I know somebody's done something to provide support for the Raspberry Pi platform environment. I haven't yet messed around with it yet, but their goal really was to have, and that's why I think the Grace Hopper thing, kicks in, which is that it can run everywhere. You know. Any other Go questions?
Well, I'd say it can run everywhere that they ported to. So the architecture was to support
ports. Right. Yeah, I mean, I think they presumably have targeted the main, largest main sort of platforms. And the other thing that's kind of interesting is that originally it was targeted as like an operating system, programming language, which makes sense, I guess, where Thompson was coming from and maybe Rob Pike and stuff like that. But what they found is that it really is a good, versatile language for a lot of different applications. There is a mobile sort of, port effort underway. I haven't heard much of it in the last 6 months or so, but the idea was that you could be developing Android applications, for instance, in Go. I mean, that would be kind of a nice thing to do. Okay, so I just want to show you quickly a walk through something with Docker, if I can find it.
Some of these architectures are starting to get delisted, like PA Risk or.
Yeah, it's news to me. PA Risk.
Maybe it's just some of the distros that are delisted.
Oh, a lot of distros have dropped, but from the kernel, definitely PA Risk packers. I've got a machine running PA Risk.
Really?
So I'll kind of close on this note and just to give you a quick look at sort of the simplicity of the Docker environment, and then we can make way for Mike. So this is the Go blog, and it's not a very frequently updated thing. So you can kind of dive in at any point, and you kind of quickly get up to speed on the whole history of Go, right? But they have this sample app, and I'll just you kind of step through it. And so what you go get GitHub. Here's the GitHub connection. So it's a package management thing as well. What it does when it downloads it, it's going to download it and it's going to look like this. Okay. So essentially what it does is it's, this command here, go get GitHub, a Golang example out yet. When you run that, it essentially downloads this folder, this directory, and in particular, this application, where you've got a simple Go application here. So it's just, standard Go stuff. Okay, and then every Docker container, it has a Docker file that basically gives you the, in some sense, it's like the build instructions for, and these things I gather can, and Mike certainly knows for sure, but they can get really complicated really fast. The more sophisticated, the more complex, the more stuff you're pouring into that container. But they all have this add, run, you've got an entry point, which is where it starts running, and then in this case, it gives you a port to work off of. And then, so once you've done that, and then you build it, and you build the container just like you build an application, and I'll just kind of quickly run through that. Actually, maybe I won't, because I probably won't be able to find it. But I think I can. Let's see if I can get this to run. See if this works. May have to go. Let's see if this works. This may not work, but oh, hang on. I may already have the thing running. Go ahead.
If you delete the old container, it'll work.
Well, is the old container still running?
Do docker ps, sudo docker ps. Space.
Space, yes.
So do docker, sudo docker space rm space space dash f space slash test.
There's no dash r and slash.
Is that what you'd expect?
What's that? Yeah. So now, if you hit your up arrow a few times, you should be able to get your command back. That one. All right, now you're running.
So I have no idea what Mike just did to my machine. But
so when you stop running a Docker container, it still actually exists.
Yeah.
And you could start it back up technically, but we just we created a new Docker container off of a Docker image.
So boom. There's my demo, it works, and obviously it's the right time for me to make way for Mike to come in. And so basically what this is though, it is running the code that was put into that Docker container that we just kind of built and then reawakened, because I had it running earlier. So the advantage of this is that if you had something really complex with lots of databases and other kinds of things, you could then pick that chunk up and pass it on to somebody else without them having to recreate and rebuild that whole system, I think. Any questions while Mike comes up? Yeah.
One final question about Go. Is it possible to tell it to dynamically link to other Go libraries?
I think so. I'm not positive.
Yeah. I mean, you would think it's hard to imagine that they it couldn't be dynamically linked. That there wouldn't be just stuff that's. But I don't know how to do it. But we'll put that on the question. We'll try and get an answer to post along with the after meeting minutes. That's a good question. Yeah. The other thing is that the environment is actually really small. It's tiny. I think the code is really pretty efficient. I think there are very good runtime sort of inspectional capabilities. It's nothing like debugging the way things used to be. So I don't know that there are any really great interactive development IDEs out there geared towards debugging. But debugging seems reasonably straightforward. It certainly is the kind of language where you can pick it up and you know, you'll be running Hello World before you know it. So, and it's very useful for, you know, any kind of systems management types of stuff that you want to do. It certainly, because of the web server, built-in functionality, it's great for doing webby kinds of, or internet kinds of stuff. And it's, you know, and I think you can do pretty high-performance computing, too, with the built-in Go routines and passing stuff back and forth. So it's definitely, it's not a toy language. It's the real deal. I think it's going to be around for, you know, for a long time to come. So any other questions?
Again, that's something I think everyone says about all their
people. You're right.
Well, C is still around. I mean, there are a lot of languages that are still... You know, how many people still do Fortran?
I know people that do.
Some people do, right?
Fortran is still very big in the scientific community.
Yeah. There's, so two things. One, in the, you know, kind of news, and Mike, you can come on up whenever, you know, I'll just get out here.
COBOL's still around, too.
COBOL's still around. Yeah, no, it's, and it, all, this stuff always will be, you know?
Phrase Harper's language.
Yeah, the bits and the bytes will be. Hey, has anybody ever been to the Deutsches Museum? In Munich, isn't that a pretty impressive? What's that?
You schedule like maybe 2 hours, and you're like, yeah, that's plenty of time. Like we blew that budget.
Yeah, yeah.
Didn't even see it all.
Yeah, I mean, you know, there's sort of one wing that's just on this kind of stuff, right? You know, digital technologies and computer technologies and encryption technologies, and you know, it's essentially a museum of, you know, the history of technology, right? And it is enormous, and you could spend, yeah. But I don't know to what extent they have the history of all languages there. They got a lot of hardware stuff as well. But you know, they have a lot of hardware that has. So there's no doubt languages stick around, and they HTML. You know, do this. Yeah.
I wonder how my skills do go to the museum and see things that you use.
I've got to admit, Android is certainly a thing. We've got it.
Thank you, Mike.
Yeah,
no problem.
Thank you.
Saving me on that demo.
All right. Thank you, Brian. And thank you, Shankar, for bringing me in. Nice to meet you guys. So I'm going to talk a little bit about Kubernetes. First, quickly about me so you guys know who I am. I'm the lead DevOps engineer at Barclay, where Shankar works as well. Barclay, we do endpoint security, so we have an endpoint security product that we roll out to Windows devices as of now, and then it reports back to a SaaS platform that our teams manage in AWS. So previously I was at PayPal and a startup called RStage. I'm the organizer of the Boston Kubernetes Meetup. My whole goal with pretty much everything I work on a day-to-day basis and you know, in my career is figure out how to run things at scale without like needing me to be woken up in the middle of the night, because that's kind of like the sysops, DevOps, like that's where I'm at. That's like, you know, I get a phone call at 11:30 p.m. or 2 a.m. You know, it's miserable, you know. My girlfriend hates it. I try to just figure out how do you make that happen less, which means the systems are more resilient overall, right? So current technologies that I'm into, obviously, is Kubernetes, Docker. Anyone use Terraform or Ansible? Chef? Puppet? All right, there we go. All right.
Salt,
yes, salt. There we go, good. And we could go back further, too. Yeah, right. But, you know, so previously I've worked a lot with Chef, so I've been to those meetups. Was anyone here at the Kubernetes meetup? No? Okay, I didn't think so. Figured you might see some repeats. All right, so you guys all know most of this stuff. Running an application on the internet, you know, DNS, networking, load balancers, server config, there's a lot of complications, right? Like, and this is, that's it, right? Like, that's like... It's mind-boggling, and you know, it goes down into the Linux kernel all the way up to like, you know, all the fourth and fifth class citizens using them. So the old way of running an app on the internet, And I'm coming at the Docker, you know, the Docker side of this from a different perspective, right? So I'm looking at it from the application perspective. So when you want to run an application, an ops team will rent, buy, or lease servers. The dev team will throw the code over the wall, right, to put on the servers. It, you know, you can connect it to the internet, and then you celebrate, you know, you've done something great. But there's a lot of inherent problems with this. There's, you know, inherent downtime, there's scalability problems, security, and it generates a huge divide between dev and ops. So if you guys aren't, you know, up on the DevOps stuff, that's kind of the core concept. It makes teams be reactive rather than proactive, and it allows, you know, prevents you from really being able to accomplish a lot of the things teams need to do. And at the end of the day, it really hurts productivity, which contributes to a loss of revenue. And that's kind of what it comes down to most of the business folks, right? So then there was the Cloudway. And the Cloudway is great, you know, using Amazon, as we were talking about at the beginning of the meeting, that you can basically have as many cores whenever you want. You can spin up multiple servers. You can rebuild and scale up and down, whatever. And the hardware is all managed. You don't have to go into a data center if a hard drive fails at 4 a.m., right? But the problems, you have a lot more servers to manage because now you inherently are taking on the risk of like, well, Amazon might just decide to take down this whole, you know, data center but leave up this other one. So I have to build in both or multiple availability zones. So it adds a management overhead. The configuration of that infrastructure also grows, so it takes on its own beast, and then you got to hire people to test that stuff, and it's a mess. Most of you guys know this stuff. You got to debug across all the different servers, they change state, you got to update packages. How do you test changes locally? All right, so we're getting the idea, right? It's some problems. And we're going to fly through a few of these things because I really want to get to the demo a bit. So you guys know this. We're going to go that past that too. All right. So what Docker does, it can solve a lot of these problems in from a high scale way, from a different perspective. Packages are awesome. They let you, you know, add tons of different things into, as an example, a Linux system. And you can, you know, you want to install such and such. All right. You got all these dependencies. It'll all resolve, probably. What Docker does as a high level, like look at that, is it's like, all right, now I've made this thing work, let's snapshot that. Let's make that something that we can then pass around. So a Docker image is something that when you've said apt-get install, blah, 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 set these environment variables, you can then snapshot it afterwards. And so the Docker file that Brian was showing earlier is the commands to produce that. Now you can do it manually, but if you have the commands to produce that, you can put that on the internet and it's publicly available, and you can also download the image from the internet. But I can also copy that source, run it in my own data center, and I feel a little bit more secure because at least I know, you know, those packages came from my own repo. So Docker takes a lot of this. It makes things a little bit easier because then you're passing around this thing that is already working. I can build and run something on my laptop here that is the exact same binaries that are running on a server. The only thing that changes is the underlying infrastructure below that. So yeah, there's always a chance that something could go wrong, but you're taking out a lot less of the problems. So we've actually already seen this earlier. The main difference between what Docker does and virtual machines, right? So what Kubernetes does on top of this is really figure out how to make this work better. So you're running a Docker container, and you know a lot of companies will just run, for an example, a Postgres server in a Docker container because then you can snapshot it. Now that's also kind of dumb because there's a lot of latency problems and something like that. But as an example, like you can run anything in a Docker container and it should have, it allows you to deploy it really quickly. And frankly, I don't know, I'm not a DBA, so I honestly don't know the best way to set up, you know, specific types of databases when I just want to try something I found on the internet. So there's guys out there who are smarter than me that know how to do this, and they're the ones that will often create the Docker containers that you can just download and try. So that's personally one of my favorite things about it. So how do we manage those containers?
Now, what my team did, and it was mostly myself, we deployed Kubernetes in a very opinionated fashion. I'm going to describe a little bit of it. But the operating system we used in Amazon is called CoreOS. Anyone ever hear of CoreOS?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So it's a very, very, very basic operating system.
No security or no?
What's that?
No security.
No security. Yeah, exactly. There's also no package manager. The updates, you have to update the whole operating system. So they're trying to take out some of the underlying sysops work on that side. Now, we cannot go into the dangers of this because we all know it. But from a high level, it allows you to work quicker and move past a lot of those problems. But what it does do is it runs two versions of Docker. Because you actually, in order to bring up Docker, you need another Docker. It's complicated. But they run two Dockers on one box, which is, it just makes it very simple because all you're running is a Linux kernel, some very base low-level operating system stuff, and then Docker containers. So you can fit far more containers on one OS, and it's what our team picked. You can always use anything, Red Hat, Debian, whatever you want. They all run Docker. What's
that? Using CoreOS on the virtual machine?
Yeah. So what we do is CoreOS on top of AWS, instances. But you can run it locally. We run it in Vagrant as well when we test and everything. Anywhere. Another key thing to talk about is etcd. Has anyone heard of etcd? Etcd, I think they also did a rewrite. I think they're in Go now as well. But it's a very fast key value store. It's very quick to network together. And one of the things that's cool with CoreOS is you can use etcd as a key value store to manage all of your servers. It's kind of all built into this, this ecosystem around CoreOS and etcd. All right, so those were some technology decisions our team made. But still, the management of Docker containers running on these systems is still up to the end user. So that's where really Kubernetes comes in here. Kubernetes allows you to run applications at scale. You can run them in groups, in logical groups, and I'm going to demo that in a few minutes. So you can segment containers, you can do virtual networking the same way that you can do it in like the cloud, but this is fast, it's instant, it's scaling up and down. You can do it across many nodes, and frankly, you've abstracted away from the actual hardware that you're running on so far, it's actually a little bit scary. I don't know what I'm running on. I know it's in Virginia somewhere on Amazon servers, but who knows? It could be 5 years old. I'm sure it's not. But what I tried to build is something that is self-healing, because that goes back to what I was talking about earlier. I don't want to be woken up. The key thing, one of the other key things with Docker really is things happen, things break. Processes break, there's memory leaks, so a process, if it gets too far, I'd rather something else just come by and like chop its head off and say, get out of here, and we just have enough of them running that we're good, we're good to go, and I don't need to be woken up. And the next day, we can have a log of that, and a developer can go fix the memory leak, right? So really, what can we do to make sure that we always have our applications running at scale, and change them as we go? So a few basic concepts of Kubernetes. I know this is a little bit high level, and in depth, but we'll get there. There's etcd, the key value store. There's a master node, or many master nodes, and minions. The minions are what actually run your containers and your applications. The masters, they both talk to etcd, and the masters make all the decisions as, in traditional clusters. The master node runs a few different services, an API server, a replication controller, which decides how many of a given application to run, a scheduler, which decides where it runs, podmaster, actually that's old, they just got rid of that in the latest version, and a proxy that actually sets up IP table rules to proxy requests to the specific services. Then there's minion nodes, which they now just call nodes. And they run proxies and the pods. And a pod is a grouping of containers. And we'll get to that in a second. So Now, the only other major thing I wanted to show you guys before we really get into the demo is what, like, you're managing this thing of Kubernetes. Let's assume it's spun up. Google has done a great job with making it easy to spin up a Kubernetes cluster. I've pre-baked one that we can use in a few minutes. But there's this architecture around these containers that it's what why people do this. So you can create a namespace. So let's say you build a cluster, you can namespace off to specific users. You know, they can only do things within their namespace. It's pretty standard, but it's the highest logical, you know, grouping that there is. Within that, there's many other different services, but one of them is pods. A pod is a one or more containers, and then you can set all sorts of things and expose specific ports the way that you would with a Docker container. Then also inherently, that can also have a liveliness probe or a readiness probe. So when you start up a container, you don't want it automatically added to a load balancer to be, you know, set on the internet. You want to wait, and you want to make sure it's live. So you can set a health check endpoint as an example, and then you can also see if it fails. You know, that's what the liveliness probe is. You can set environment variables. You can set it to always pull from the Docker registry or from your own Docker registry. This is our registry, pulling my awesome app. So now, if you take that concept of one or many containers within a pod, right? Now, a replication controller allows you to run many pods, right? So you could say, I want one of this pod, and then later you could scale it up to be three. So that's what I have here, three replicas. My mouse doesn't work. That's cool. So the replicas line right under spec there is basically the only difference between the previous one and this one. And then the metadata and selector values is what actually allows the connection between a replication controller and a pod. And then on top of that, you can do something called deployments, which is basically saying there are unique like versions of replication controllers. So if you want to modify an environment variable, you can do a new deployment, which basically will automatically give you A/B deployments, rolling upgrades, all that stuff. You can, it's already built in. It's straightforward, and it works really well. We use it pretty regularly. Now, that's pretty much the core concepts for the Docker side of things. Then there's services, so you can expose a service on a port. You can expose it with a load balancer. Like I did here, and it'll actually talk to the underlying infrastructure. So in my case, it'll talk to Amazon, spin up a load balancer for you to run your application for against. And it'll actually network the ports to match that load balancer, and it will set up the security groups to make sure that only that application can connect out. One other example, you can also set up ingress routes, which basically lets you say, you know, I want our portal to be served at this, slash web goes to my APIs, just slash goes to my other app. It's just, you know, kind of like a configuration language. But it's all, you know, built in, and it's, I don't know, that's one of the main benefits, is that it's all, you know, it's all written out in YAML or JSON. There's a slew of other components. There's probably 10 more that are not on this list, but there's jobs. You can run short or long-term running jobs, daemon sets that run on all your servers, horizontal auto-scaling, so if you know you get high CPU utilization on specific pods, you can say, I want 5 instead of 3, you can have it scale up. And you can do secrets that prevent, you know, that you can Base64 encode specific data, and then it's, you know, it's mounted. It's very complicated the way they do it, but it basically, you know, it's a secret manager. It's okay. It works. It's not very secure. All right, so let's get to the heart of this. What does this actually mean? It really helps engineers work better and faster and iterate more quickly. We really wanted to be able to run things locally on our laptops at our company, as well as you know, on our servers. And if one day Amazon has a problem, God forbid, like everything on the internet, Netflix included, will go down and every teenager will die. But beyond that, like we might have to move to Google someday, or you know, we got to be ready for anything, really. So Kubernetes helps a lot with that. And it allows you to automate a lot of your services. There's very little management overhead, so the way that our team runs it, when a server is destroyed, a new one comes back up, it configures itself and calls in, and there's no configuration overhead. We'll move on from there. All right, so real quick, before I move on to the demo, I'm gonna forget to mention this later, so I put it now. If anyone is actually interested in Kubernetes, we have a meetup May 9th, bostonkubernetes.com. All right, so the demo that I'm about to do is two parts. The first, I've open sourced here on the Barclay Protect site. So it's just github.com/barclayprotect/kubernetes-demo. And what we're gonna do is, you guys see? So I've spun up a cluster for us over here. So this is in Amazon, for those of you not familiar. Amazon Cloud, I spun it up over in Oregon because I didn't want it to mess with our actual infrastructure right now. But with Kubernetes, if you go to github.com/Kubernetes, they have a fair amount of pretty good documentation. Now, you know, you look at the project, it doesn't look that great, but if you actually go to their website, it's all, you know, well documented and everything over here. But one of the cool things when you look at the documentation is they have a way of running Kubernetes. You can pick your right solution, you know, and you can run it locally, whether you want to run it in Docker or in a VM or no VM. If you want a cloud-based, you can use Google, you can use AWS, Azure, CenturyLink. I think they're working on a few other ones as well, OpenStack. And then there's obviously you can do it from scratch. So my team, what we built was from scratch on our own, just because when I started building this, the Google way wasn't scalable. It really would not stay up. It was more for like development purposes. So what I open sourced to you guys is kind of using their way to build a quick test environment. I jumped pretty quickly. Does anyone have any questions to start off with before I go into the actual demo? Okay, cool. What we're going to do here is we've got a Kubernetes environment up and running. You know, if you go look online, I just took a simple shell script to wrap their other scripts, and it'll check to see if you're running Linux or Darwin. I didn't test Linux, I'm sorry. We have a Kubernetes cluster running right here. So what we're going to see here is nothing. So as I described earlier, we have namespaces in Kubernetes. So it's locked to a specific namespace. So right now we have a cluster running, and this is the cluster that we just saw. There's a master node and four minions. The master node is also running etcd as the key value store for the whole thing. It's backed by an EBS volume by default. And then these minions, I think they also have EBS volumes mounted to them. And so when they come up, they get specific parts of the Kubernetes infrastructure to set up. So that includes a dashboard, a monitoring infrastructure running InfluxDB, if anyone's familiar, a proxy to proxy requests around between the different nodes, DNS, so it has its own internal DNS system, Heapster, which is a management, it's metrics, essentially. FluentD to grab Elasticsearch, or to grab logs, so it'll take all the logs from all your containers and put them into Elasticsearch for you. And then at the top you see the Elasticsearch V1s as well. So what we can do with this, these are the components that you shouldn't really ever have to touch unless you're like me and you decide to build your own. But what we can do here is, I decided to go the best route that I could, the most simple way of explaining this concept. And that's the good old LAMP stack. I don't know how many of you guys, most people here have probably run a LAMP stack at some point in their career or been involved with one. So we're going to start up by running WordPress with a Postgres database. I think Postgres. MySQL. MySQL database. So we're going to create a couple volumes, because the concept that I'm trying to show you guys is if you're running something on a server, it can, you know, if that server goes down, it can be gone, right? Well, the cloud solves that. But you gotta write a lot of scripts, right? You gotta write scripts to say like, oh, if this server goes down, disconnect it, attach it over here, and move this IP address, and it's a mess if you really try to look at it and do it at scale with a company. So what we're gonna do, I'm gonna create two volumes here, each for 10 gigs, not for any real reason, because we're not gonna put anything in this. But so here we go, now we're gonna have our WordPress volume, and we're going to have our MySQL volume. So we're going to grab this volume ID, and Kubernetes is actually aware of these, I can't make that any bigger, I apologize. Kubernetes is actually aware of the underlying infrastructure because of the way that we've set it up. So here's what a WordPress front end looks like in it as a replication controller. And remember, when I said replication controller, it basically means that at all times, it's going to make sure there's at least one of these running. So if it sees one is no longer responding to a ping or something, it'll spin another one up and start directing traffic there. So in this configuration, you can see my great WordPress DB password. And then we're going to replace over here the volume ID. It's hard-coded in this sense, but you can also make this a lot more dynamic using an API. But basically what this says is we're going to create a volume here that we're calling WordPress Persistent Storage, and as you see highlighted above it, then we're mapping it to this pod in this container. So I'm going to do the same thing with our MySQL container, which is very similar. You can set a CPU limit. You can pick your Docker image and your version of MySQL as an example. Those are tags in Docker containers. You can expose specific ports, so I'm exposing port 3306. And then we're going to take this image here, or the volume, and put it there as well. Okay, so I've shown you those two. Then we also have a service for each one of these. So you have pods, you have containers running in those pods. Now you need to expose them to each other and to the outside world. So the first one is like the backing database, right? So you got your MySQL database. We're going to expose it on port 3306. But that's it. Like, we don't actually want to expose it to the world. We just want to expose it internally within our namespace. Then we have our WordPress service over here, which we are exposing externally by making it a type load balancer. And so what that does is it'll actually spin up an AWS load balancer, which I'm going to do right now because it takes a minute. Kubectl is basically the command line tool for running things against Kubernetes. And so I'm going to pass all of these files in my current directory for Kubernetes to start spinning up and everything. So if we start watching here what Kubernetes is doing, it's going to create a WordPress container and a MySQL container. Now, the key with this is it's doing some cool stuff behind the scenes if we go back to our Amazon. So if you see over there on the right side here, the state is available on these volumes. It just means they're just kind of sitting there ready to be used. They're provisioned, but they're not in use. They're not connected to a server. When I created them. Now if I refresh, we'll see that it's actually in use. It's mapped it to specific servers over here. I don't care what servers, it's just Kubernetes decided. That's a little scary thing to kind of get used to thinking about it, but you know, it makes everyone's lives a little bit easier. So now we can see our services are running, they've passed their health checks. And if we go over here into our load balancers, or Amazon, we'll see a new load balancer has come up. Now, unfortunately, load balancers take a few minutes to actually pass validation. So I'm going to change it right now so that the health passes quicker, but it still takes a few minutes. But essentially now, this load balancer will map to our WordPress site, which we'll see in a second when that finishes coming up. In the meantime, do you guys have any questions on what I've described so far? Yeah.
These containers run databases that are like read-write, the rest of transactions.
Yeah.
How do they keep all that stuff in sync across the different instances when you're
talking about? So it's pretty much the same concept as if you're running that database on hardware. You got to have, you know, a proper replica set. You have to, you know, have a rewrite, you know, master slave. You have your, you know, read slaves. Whatever your actual backing data store. This is just a demo of, you know, I would never run a MySQL without any, you know, replicas in production. So, you know, but you can spin it up the same way that you would run it on just regular hardware, pretty much. Yeah?
How much would you have to change to move this over to, say, Google Cloud?
Yeah.
How much is it?
The everything I just showed you would be identical except for those values for the volumes. So once, you know, once I spun up the Kubernetes infrastructure, and Google Cloud will actually, I think they have like a one button push that you can say, give me a Kubernetes infrastructure. You wait about 3 or 4 minutes and they spin it up, they create certs for you, all that stuff. And then you just, you know, we would go create those volumes, put the IDs in there and push it up, and it would function almost identically. Yeah.
Have you ever tried making a copy of your production infrastructure in a separate?
In what sense?
Like taking the stuff that you stand up in production and standing the whole thing, the lab is going to
be. Yeah. We I mean, I spin up and down full environments of our Kubernetes infrastructure every day. We have 3 environments now, I think. And
on a different provider.
Oh, on a different provider. I have not done that in a while. I've run Kubernetes. I started looking at Kubernetes when I was at PayPal, and they were all OpenStack. So I started running it on OpenStack. And, you know, the YAML language, the configuration language, was basically the same. You know, it's the underlying Kubernetes piece that, you know, that it's some changes. But you're still running a Linux VM, so it doesn't really matter, you know, that from that perspective. So. We do, yeah. Any other questions?
Yeah. What was the key for making one service public and one private? We had MySQL with the links both internally and.
Yeah.
Do you have like a load balancer to the web server?
Yeah. You just change the type.
So what was the type for the MySQL?
I don't think we actually needed it.
There's no type that means it's just the internal. Or...
So when there's none listed, it implies a different one called node port. And what node port is basically it assigns a random port on the box. They have a range that you can set. And it takes one of those ports and assigns it to that that service. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't expose that anywhere. It just you have to run it on a service because that's kind of the way they decided to build the infrastructure. And then if you wanted, so I actually started using a lot of this before they had a solid load balancer platform. So I just did everything with a node port that would map it to a specific port on a host.
Okay.
And then we would mount that host, you know, I did the rest of it from there to the load balancer, the external load balancer. So, yeah. All right, let's take another look, see if this thing is up now. Oh, come on. The demo gods are not with me today. Oh, wait. Oh, come on. All right, well, it does not want to do that. Look at one more thing. Oh, now they're out of service. I think it's still coming up. Looks like something, it's not working properly. Of course.
It's because you're demoing.
Yeah, it is because I'm demoing. So. It's funny because at the Kubernetes meetup I presented and my demo failed. So I made up the rest of the demo, which is kind of the second half of my demo. So what I'm going to do now, I swear this works, it's just who knows what's happening at this exact moment. But what we're going to do now, unless anyone has any immediate questions? Yeah.
You mentioned earlier that there's some DNS service part
yeah.
of Kubernetes.
Yep.
Can you describe what the point of it is, what it's doing?
Sure. It actually allows you anything within the YAML anything you see here in YAML, these labels essentially, the metadata here, as well as within services, you can actually then use that as a DNS structure. So In every Kubernetes infrastructure, you can call, I think it's Kubernetes.home is like how you reach the API. And if you want, if you have a namespace called my app, and your app was called API, you could call api.myapp.local or whatever, you know, whatever the schema is, and you can actually connect between services using that DNS structure. That's the main reason they do it, and it's kind of, I forget what they called it, but it's kind of a downwards API that allows you to drill into specific services. I don't know. It works. It's kind of a weird service because it actually queries the API of Kubernetes and then, you know, runs a DNS server against that API for the API to use. And then your other services can use.
Say that again?
Yeah. So there's a DNS. So your Kubernetes API server knows everything. It's, you know, it's God. And then you have a DNS server that queries that API to actually create a DNS record, right? Once that record is created, other elements within Kubernetes reference that record. And it just makes it, you know, makes it more of an HTTP request rather than a, you know, it makes the whole infrastructure consistent. Right. Yeah.
Is it possible your demo is it available because it's an Amazon security group that needs to be updated?
No, so it actually takes care of that for you. So that's one of the cool things that, in theory, unless it didn't work during my demo, if we go into these minions, we'll see security groups over here. So this is, if you're not familiar with the way Amazon or a lot of the cloud providers work, you assign a security group to different instances, and you can allow or disallow ports, right? It's basic, you know, networking, but the virtual way. So what they actually do is we allow communication on all ports, in this case, between specific sources. So these are the other security groups within Kubernetes. But I believe what we'll see when I clear this is you'll actually see this other security group right here from port 80, which is the port we exposed. So that's the port that the load balancer is actually sitting on. We should see another for, so there's the 3389, which is the node port that that Kubernetes takes care of behind the scenes. It mounts the service to a node port on a host, on this specific host that this security group is assigned. And then it takes care of it for you. It's pretty cool, actually.
Kubernetes is doing that?
Yeah. Yeah.
I think that's a lot right there. Because the security groups are getting tangled up and starting to work.
Exactly. When I saw that, my mind was blown, right? All right, so one of the things I can show you real quickly with this set is, you know, clearly something's messed up in this cluster. I don't know why. But if we look at it, oh look, it went into an error state. That's cool. looks like the MySQL actually like was working at one point. So what I can do, when I run this command, I can actually see what host it's running on. So we can see over here, it's this 047. So if I go into AWS, find that host, right here. We can see down here that it's mounted this other volume, and that's the volume that I was talking about earlier. So what I can actually do is if we delete this pod, it's going to terminate that pod and create a new container. And it's actually going to take a second because what it does is it disconnects that volume from the given server and mounts it up on another server. So we can see here, 45 is the new server that it picked. And if we refresh this, we'll see down here, that volume is no longer attached there. And we see that it's been attached over here as one example of, you know, they just take care of some of that for you. You know, that's a couple weeks worth of development work to make it work that smoothly, you know, in hackery shell scripting that I would usually do, or Python or whatever. You know, like it just, you're always making those fixes, and they kind of take care of some of that for you. So, all right, so now we're going to jump over to the real dangerous stuff. our production environment. So this is, we have two production environments. This is our prod 2 environment, which is not really live to, you know, we're not running our real traffic on it at the moment, but it's real. You know, we use it all the time, and we're actively deploying to it. So this is our app, one of our apps. This is the front end for our web service. You know, we can see it functioning here. And this is where the scary part happens. We can see our cluster right here. We have etcd. We have 3 etcd nodes. We have 3 master nodes. And I think 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 minion nodes. And for those of you that are familiar with Amazon, the way that I've set this up is that within our auto-scaling groups, we have 3 different types for this per environment. So what that means is that for any given time, we'll have that many number of the servers running in the desired column name. So if in a second, I'm going to delete a server, and this is going to bring up a brand new server, I'm not going to configure it by hand at all. And you know, it's going to make sure that we always have that number running. So I can, you know, we'll see. You'll see. I'm going to get dirty. Last time I did this, my boss was in the room, so this is a lot better. So we're going to, I have to switch my command line over here to point to our server. Nice and secure now that you guys can see it all. All right, so here are all of our services running. I'm gonna make this a little bit smaller so that we can get the whole thing on here. And I think there's a few more that aren't wrapping properly, but this gives you a concept of like what a real cluster looks like that we're running. All these things on the bottom here that are kube system, those are all the system related tasks that are running. We have Elasticsearch, you know, FluentD grabbing logs and pumping them over to Elasticsearch for us at all times. We have a number of controllers managing all these different aspects. I've replicated our DNS so that it runs on two. We have 2 sets of the DNS running that we were talking about a few minutes ago. And then at the top half, that Barclay stack section, that's where we're actually running our applications. We won't get into the labeling. I didn't pick that labeling. They fixed that in a newer version. But basically, we're using deployments so that we can push a new version out whenever, and it'll update that that hash that you see in the deployments deployment RC column there. All right, so we're gonna pick a good server over here. I don't know, 119. What's running on that? That looks like a lot. I'm just going to grab the server and terminate it. I have a lot of confidence in this stuff, as you can tell. So we'll see right now the status of this server. It's now shutting down. If we go over here, Kubernetes has not quite seen this yet. Now, I will be honest that they're still working out some of the kinks with some of this, and frankly, I haven't set up all the networking with this to be perfect. But, you know, all right, so it's hanging, of course, live demo. But this problem is actually, they're working on it, it's almost fixed in the latest version. But what we'll see right now, once Kubernetes realizes that node has gone bad, we're going to see it terminate, as you can see right now. It's terminating all the pods that were running on those servers, just assuming they're gone. Who cares? You know, let's keep going. So then it starts spinning up all these new pods. And by now, our site over here, and Chrome, we were talking earlier about the Chrome sticker I need to remove from my laptop. You know, so this is working again, but we've lost a server. A whole server has come down. You can see a bunch of stuff has gone down. That's not good. but we just survived what a lot of companies would consider catastrophic failure. And I did it on purpose. And at the same time, if you guys feel like it, I will delete one of the master nodes as well because of the same concept. This thing will recover itself. It just, that's what it does. You know, and this actually will not hang anything. And I just took down one of the main core infrastructure pieces of Kubernetes. So you can build this thing and mold this thing however you want with any infrastructure, right? But it takes care of so much for you. I was able to spend time to kind of make this thing a bit more resilient. And you know, when I do a hard refresh like that, our site still loads just fine. And most things have since returned. Now there's a few of these, like this one that you can see, are still in a pending state, and that's kind of demoing what I talked about earlier. Those are moving volumes around. That's one of our services. We use etcd, and so it actually has to. We have a volume that stores etcd data, and we actually are moving it between servers right now in the background. And if anyone has fought the issue with running Quorum with anything like that, it could be absolute hell. And this thing takes care of that. Assuming you can run enough of anything, we can take care of whatever we want. So as an example, if we were talking about the DNS service earlier. So if I want to make more DNS services, there's one command. So we look at our replication controllers for namespace of cube system. We can see the different replication controllers that tell you how many desired and how many you currently have of a given service. So I'm going to go look over here at the cube DNS, and I'm going to do scale replicas 4. Why not?
Missing an L.
Typo.
Thank you. 4, we have to do the namespace command because they're a pain in the butt. And that didn't work. Replicas. Oh, space. Come on. Scale replicas. Nope.
Save. Don't you need to specify the DNS?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we need that. Good call.
What the?
Oh, yeah, they changed this. 1 second. There we go. All right. Sorry about that. So now we can see it's scaling up there, so they have a command line tool, which obviously I just fat fingered a lot, but they do have a nice API that lets you do all of this as well. You can do it dynamically. They also have a service that, as you can see right now, it's taking a few minutes because it's got to download all these containers. So that if you look at the kubeDNS line, you see 4/4, that means there's 4 containers running in one pod. Each one of these is a pod. So that, if you need this specific DNS they use requires etcd as well. So it spins up its own little etcd, and has a DNS server, an API server, and one other component. You can actually, those are all different Docker images. You can actually preload those on all the instances if you want to make things a bit faster when you have failure like that. Unless anyone has it, do you guys have any more questions?
You play around with OpenShift at all?
I have a little bit, yeah. I use it a bit at PayPal, not very heavily. It's a similar concept, not in a while. Do you have experience?
No, I'm just curious about it. Seems like it's a nice, pretty front end to Kubernetes, and I don't know how useful it is, whether it's worth investigating.
Yeah, sure. So I know that, I think for a while they were, they had their own thing going on top of OpenStack. And since they've actually started moving over to running on top of Kubernetes, a few of the guys from OpenShift were at our meetup as well. And they have a pretty active OpenShift meetup here in Boston. I personally like, since I'm the guy running a lot of this stuff, I like to understand what it's doing. And Kubernetes, since it's all open source, it's all out there and in public, you can really just, hammer at it and figure things out. And I couldn't do that with some of those. And that might just be my own personal opinion, but also, I don't know. At the time when we were deciding our technology choices, we were using AWS, and I said, well, I know how to write really good cloud init scripts that can just do things. So, which, if you haven't done cloud init, it kind of sucks, but it made spinning up that cluster pretty instant. We'll actually see some of the, you can actually see some of these hosts are now coming online as a new server. But yeah, sorry. I don't have a lot of experience with that. Yeah.
You were saying that Kubernetes can run with any infrastructure. So like a mixed environment, just anything, any operating system.
I mean, any, you know, it can run, I think it's Go, just like Docker. Whatever you want to compile it on, you can run it on. If you put the time and energy into compiling it, the cross-compilation discussion of linked libraries and stuff aside. Also, you can run it within a container. So anywhere that you can run Docker, you can run Kubernetes. So that's one of the arguments that they've made is that, well, let's let the Docker guys figure out how to run containers on each type of system, and then you can run Kubernetes using Docker on anything. Now, there's a number of people using, I've seen people doing, you know, Raspberry Pi clusters that they'll spin up, I don't know why, but as you can see, there's a whole cube system thing that takes quite a few resources to actually run.
Don't give Brian ideas.
Yeah. But yeah.
I think I demoed on it, the Google Plex a month ago.
Okay, yeah.
A stack of Raspberry Plex.
Right, and you can do some cool stuff with it.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, in production sense, it doesn't do me a whole lot of good. So, I stick to the virtual stuff. And I mean, we've talked vaguely about going physical with a lot of this, but I had to drive 6 hours once to go fix it, something at a data center on the day after Thanksgiving. So I'm sticking virtual for now.
How about Docker Swarm? How does this compare to, is that a completely different?
No, that's actually a great point. So Kubernetes was highly developed by Google. It basically, Google has been using containers for a long time. Does anyone here work for Google? That's a good, quick question. Do you? Okay. So they use a lot of containers internally. They've used them for a very long time before Docker came up with them. Now, and what Docker did is they basically took containers and kind of commercialized them using an open source platform, and then realized they didn't know how to make any money doing that. And they were like, uh-oh. Like, we're onto something here, but we need to make money doing it. You know, and as you can see, they have huge investors right now. Kubernetes kind of came out of Google as kind of like, all right, let's get this thing, let's take what we've built internally, redevelop it, you know, externally, against other APIs and other services. Now, Docker Swarm, I think it was actually another company that they bought, that Docker purchased, and they've now integrated it as part of their product. It's very similar to what this does, but it doesn't necessarily always integrate, you know, with Amazon or with GCE, to my knowledge. It's been a while since I looked at it, but it basically allows you to link your Docker environments between multiple machines. And to start, it was very, you know, just letting you run containers that were knowledgeable of other containers. And since it's grown, I think they have a networking layer, and they have a few other orchestration layers now as well. But the concept of Kubernetes is a little bit more broad than Swarm.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.